This morning, I have a little bit old, a little new, as they say sometimes, but I was remarking to someone Wednesday afternoon, actually an hour or so before prayer meeting. I said, "Boy, you know, I really wish I had something else for prayer meeting tonight." And they said, "Why?" I said, "Because what I'm speaking about now really needs to go out Sabbath morning." But anyhow, I went ahead and spoke on part of that. But today, I really feel an unction to not only finish what I started on Wednesday night, but also to review and to add some new. I took a few things out, so it'd be a little fresh, but there's going to be some old, some new here, and I hope that it can still be a blessing to you. The title of our message today is The Christian Oxymoron, Christian something or another. We're going to talk about that in just a minute, but I have some slides, and those who do have the slides, I'm going to go to slide number two. And in slide number two, you see a picture of Mike Huckabee. Some of you know Mike Huckabee is a Baptist minister. In slide number three, does anybody recognize John Danforth? He is a former senator from Missouri and an ambassador of the United States to the United Nations. Maybe you knew that already. Slide number four, Andrew Young, United Church of Christ preacher. I believe Danforth was from the Episcopal Church. I believe that was noted. And slide number five, we all recognize Martin Luther King Jr., of course, a Baptist. Slide number six, Jesse Jackson, also a Baptist. Slide number seven, Pat Robertson, also a Baptist. And who could forget the late Jerry Falwell? Now, these are all ministers. They come from different churches, and we could have put up a host of many others. These are just some that you might have some name recognition with. What do they have in common besides being ministers? They all have been heavily involved in politics in one form or another at one time of their life. Now, we're going to talk about the Christian oxymoron, and that is Christian politics today. Christian politics, because it's an oxymoron. We're going to see why. But I want you to first turn with me in your Bible to 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 21. It says, "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps." And I don't think that I would be taking too much liberty with this text to say that in principle, as Christians, who are supposed to be people who are Christ-like, it is our duty and responsibility to follow Christ as our example, not only in suffering, but in all things. Would you concur with me on that, that that's reasonable? There's no one text in the Bible that says Christ is your example in all things. But clearly, the Bible does portray Christ as being our example. And if we would notice from the book of Ellen White's That I May Know Him on our next slide, she says, "Some who claim to believe in Jesus Christ as their Savior have said, no one can keep the law. On this point, the words of Christ are decisive. He says, I have kept my Father's commandments, and he is our example in all things." So the testimony of Christ is that he is, in fact, our example in all things. The specific context of this statement is that by God's grace, we can keep all the commandments. But he is to be our example in all things. Now let's turn to another text in our Bibles in John chapter 18. But in John chapter 18, verse 36, Jesus is before Pilate. And Pilate answered in verse 35, "Am I a Jew? Thine own nation and the chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done?" And Jesus answered him, and he said, now notice carefully in verse 36, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence." In two distinct places here, in this verse, in this little talk to Pilate, Jesus says, "My kingdom is not of this world." It's of another place altogether. These, I think, are some of the most profound words for us today that we need to understand that Jesus spoke about. And they help us to focus our efforts in the upbuilding of his kingdom, because remember Jesus, as he taught for those 3.5 years, he spoke about a theme called the kingdom a lot. The kingdom of God is within you. The kingdom of God cometh not with observation, and so on. But if there was ever a person with dynamic abilities to become a politician, if there was ever an orator who could speak the right words with the right pathos to be a statesman, it would have been Jesus Christ. And yet, throughout his ministry, he himself stayed so totally aloof from political, civil things, so much so that he would not even attempt to negotiate an inheritance dispute. When someone asked him in Luke chapter 12, verse 13, "Master, speak to my brother that he divide the inheritance with me," Jesus simply responded, "Man, who made me a judge or divider over you?" in verse 14. And in John chapter 12 and verse 47, "And if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not, for I came not to judge the world, but to save the world." Jesus didn't come to be a political, civil arbitrator. Jesus would act as no judge or magistrate upon this earth. And if we are to follow his example, did we read that he's our example?
Yes.
If we are to follow his example, then I believe, beloved, that we should avoid all forms of civil politics. Mm-hmm. Now, to become a U.S. citizen, there's two ways. You can be born here, or you can become what's called a naturalized citizen. You've been a foreign citizen, you've come in, you've made application, you've passed the screening, you've become a nationalized person. But to obtain a U.S. passport, you either have to be born in the United States. This is how you become a citizen of the United States. You either are born here or you become naturalized. And that's the only way you can become a citizen and get a passport. And a passport, you know, you think about the word passport, it helps you to pass through ports, helps you to get places. But friends, what we need is a heavenly passport. But to get into heaven, you've got to have a passport from heaven. You've got to become a citizen of heaven. Now, how do you do that? Jesus told us in John chapter 3 and verse 3, he was speaking to Nicodemus one night, and he told him, he said, "You must be what?
Born
again." But look at the context of this. If we could go back to John chapter 3 for just a moment. "There was a man of the Pharisees, verse 1, named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him." And so Nicodemus is stating right at the beginning, "I recognize that you are an ambassador of God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see" what? "The kingdom of God." But what do you have to get in the kingdom of God? You have to have a passport, see? And the passport comes through being born again. Just as you are born in the United States, you become a United States citizen. We, becoming a citizen in the heavenly Canaan, are done. We do that by birth, by spiritual birth. We must be born again. In verse 7, Jesus said, "You must be born again." In Romans chapter 14 and verse 17, Romans chapter 14, verse 17, Paul speaks about the kingdom of God. And he says that the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. What we need, friends, to be a part of this kingdom of righteousness is not meat and drink and things of this physical, carnal, fleshly world. What we need are things that are intangible, that we can't put our hand on. We need righteousness and we need peace. And that's what we need to become a member of the heavenly kingdom, as we are born of God and born of the Spirit. Now, the Apostle Paul outlined the position of the Christian when he noted that we are ambassadors for Christ. If we turn to 2 Corinthians in verse 20, Paul said, "Now we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God." The Apostle Paul tells us here that we are to be reconciled to God, that we are ambassadors for Christ. And I know Brother Leon, he likes these 1893 and 1895 General Conference sermons by A.T. Jones really well. And he was quoting from, he said, the 1893 bulletins this morning. I want to quote to you from the 1895 bulletin for just a minute, because there's no one in the history of the Seventh-day Adventist Church who has ever studied more and I believe understood more than A.T. Jones about the issue of church-state relations and religious liberty and these kind of things. But here's something he said concerning this verse. He first of all quotes 1 Peter 4:10. And as every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. And John says, so each one of us are to be a minister in some way. We're all ambassadors for Christ. None of us are to let this work go to someone else. And commenting on this, A.T. Jones said, so then we are ambassadors for Christ. An ambassador is one sent and accredited by one government as the representative of that government to another country. Now the principle of ambassadorship prohibits him from any interference, whatever, with the political concerns of the government to which he is accredited. If the British ambassador to the United States or the ambassador from France or any other of these countries should express an opinion upon or take any part in any of the political concerns of this country, his sovereign would be immediately notified that he was no longer an accepted person here and would be called upon to withdraw him from the position of ambassador to his country. That has been done at least twice in my recollection. We are ambassadors for Christ. The people who are building up the beast and his image profess to stand in the place of and profess to be ambassadors for Christ. Yet they not only express opinions, but they lay down laws, they manipulate campaigns, they mold politics, and shape the whole political course of the government among the nations and the people to whom they are accredited, and thus violate the first, the last, and every principle that is involved in ambassadorship. Our preaching the message and the warning against the worship of the beast and his image, against the evils which are simply the result of the violation of the principles here laid down, our opposition to that, our warning against it must be one of principle and not merely in theory, nor from policy. Unless our proclamation against it is founded upon principle and is loyal to the principle, our proclamation will amount to nothing. If we hold in theory only that it is wrong and make the proclamation against it, even in the words of Scripture, and in practice ourselves violate the principle, our proclamation will amount to nothing. Let me just stop there for a minute. Jones is telling us that we can profess something, but then if we don't really act it, it means nothing. We can profess to believe this, but then we can become little governments and tyrannical and rule over people. But remember that Jesus said, all ye are brethren. And I think that was one of A.T. Jones' favorite texts. He said that over and over and over. All ye are brethren. So that our connection with this must be with the principle. And that in principle, and in loyalty to the principle, and that from the heart, not in theory, not asserting to it merely. The principles of Jesus Christ speak to the heart. They take hold of the heart, and are of value only as they have hold upon the heart. If they do not have hold upon the heart, the man who professes these principles will violate them in his actions, no matter what his profession. And that's from the General Conference Bulletin of April 4, 1895. Now notice something else that Jesus said to his disciples in John chapter 15. John chapter 15, verse 19. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because you're not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. You know, friends, one of the surest signs that we are on the wrong path, one of the surest signs that we are not working for the upbuilding of the kingdom of Christ, is if the world loves us. If the world praises you and has great accolades for you, friends, two do not walk together except they be agreed. And if the world loves you and the world praises you, it's because the world is in agreement with you and you are in agreement with the world. Now, Paul says that we are ambassadors for Christ. But Paul said something else very important in Philippians chapter 3. In verse 20, it says, for our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when we think of this word conversation, we usually think of that which we speak. But conversation in Old English simply means lifestyle, all that we do. And in fact, this Greek word for conversation means citizen, or place of citizenship. And it's the word that we derive our English word politics from today. And so Paul is saying that our politics are not of this earth. They're of heaven. They're heavenly things. And that's where our lifestyle, our interest should be. And therefore, for a Christian to become involved in the politics of this world without the direct intervention of God, such as an example was in the case of Daniel, is to deny that deny before heaven that he or she is a citizen of heaven. Now, Jones also commented on this verse in those same General Conference sermons of 1895, and I'd like to just share with you a little bit of what he said. Now our citizenship. The citizenship of every Christian is in heaven. What has any citizen of heaven or the heavenly government rightly to do with the political or governmental affairs of any other government or any other kingdom? In fact, what has a citizen of any government rightly to do with the political concerns or management of any other government? Many people who profess to be of those whose citizenship is in heaven, and notice he's got that in quote marks too. See, he recognizes that this is what Philippians 3:20 is saying. Many people who profess to be of those whose citizenship is in heaven are constantly involving themselves in the political workings of the governments of this earth. They profess to have a citizenship in heaven, and yet they manipulate the affairs of the kingdom of earth. They profess to be citizens of the kingdom of God, yet they propose to regulate the affairs of the governments of men. But that is a thing that never can rightly be done. If a citizen of Great Britain should come into the United States, still retaining his citizenship in the government of Great Britain, and should take any part or attempt to take part in the political affairs of this government, his action in that respect would be resented by every citizen of the United States. It matters not with what party he might wish to ally himself and work. They would not have it. They would say to him, "That is none of your business. We do not belong here. You are a citizen of another country. If the laws of this country do not suit you, that has nothing to do with the case. The political systems of this country suit us. And if the things do not suit you, just let them alone, or else change your citizenship from the government to which you belong and bring your citizenship here, and then begin to discuss the laws and how they should be made and what they should be." You know that that is so. You know that that is the way that a citizen of another country would be treated by all the citizens of this country if he should undertake to manipulate, to control, or have any part in the political concerns of this country. That is not denying his right to live here. He may do that. But all do deny his right, and his very citizenship in another country denies his right to have anything to do with the citizenship of this country or with the political affairs of this country. And that's from the General Conference Bulletin, again, of April the 4, 1895. Now, the Bible tells us that this system that we call the papacy today, Roman Catholicism, that it is described in Revelation 17 as a harlot or as a prostitute. In Revelation chapter 13, it is described as a ravenous beast. You might say, why? Why did God use these symbols? God used the harlot to represent the spiritual adultery and fornication that she commits against God with her false doctrines and her false teachings, leading people to worship, for example, a false god. But in Revelation chapter 13, she is depicted as a devouring beast, a ravenous beast, because of her union with the state, a union of church and state. You know, it's interesting that the papacy itself claims to have killed not one heretic. Not one martyr has ever had their blood been shed by the papacy, according to their version of it. No, they have simply condemned those people as heretics and then turned them over to the state to let the state deal with the heretic as the state would. But of course, they've done this knowing that the state would kill that person. We may honestly believe today that social and moral issues may be dressed the best by civil government. But this is not so. The example of Jesus clearly demonstrates that if we wish to truly help people, we have to reach them on an inner level, not the outer level, not the level where we compel and force and coerce them in their physical sense, because you don't help someone like that. No one will ever go to heaven because they did the right form or followed the right function, anything outwardly. The government under which Jesus lived was corrupt and oppressive. On every hand were crying abuses, extortion, intolerance, and grinding cruelty. Let me just stop for a minute. Does that remind you of any governments today that you know of? Maybe. But this was the way it was in the day of Jesus. He lived under the Roman government, and she says that it was a government that was corrupt, it was oppressive, and on every hand were crying abuses, extortion, intolerance, and grinding cruelty. She continues. Yet the Savior attempted no civil reforms. How many civil reforms? None. He attacked no national abuses, nor condemned the national enemies. He did not interfere with the authority or administration of those in power. Now, let me just stop there. If we were to apply this today, then I would probably need to be very careful how I speak about Mr. Obama, how I speak about Iraq or Iran or Afghanistan or the Soviet Union. If I'm to follow the example of Christ, then I'm to stay aloof from those things. It doesn't mean that we're not aware of these things happening. We know that there are political things going on. We know that there are wars and rumors of wars. And as Christians, we need to be knowledgeable of things that may indeed fulfill Bible prophecy. But it doesn't mean that we are there to support, to condemn, or to praise. We need to be very careful if we're going to follow the example of Jesus. Continuing, he did not interfere with the authority of the administration of those in power. He who was our example, and here she's using that expression that he's our example, and she's using it in the context of political civil affairs. He who was our example kept aloof from the earthly governments, not because he was indifferent to the woes of men, but because the remedy did not lie in merely human and external measures. To be efficient, the cure must reach men individually and must regenerate the heart. Jesus said, you must be born again. And that's, friends, the only way that people are going to be helped. Not by the decisions of courts or councils, or legislative assemblies, not by the patronage of worldly great men is the kingdom of Christ established, but by the implanting of Christ's nature in humanity through the work of the Holy Spirit. As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. Here is the only power that can work the uplifting of mankind, and the human agency for the accomplishment of this work is the teaching and practicing of the Word of God. When the Apostle Paul began his ministry in Corinth, that populous, wealthy, and wicked city, polluted by the nameless vices of heathenism, he said, I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. Writing afterward to some of those who had been corrupted by the foulest sins, he could say, but ye are washed, ye are sanctified, ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 11 and 1:4. Now, as in Christ's day, the work of God's kingdom lies not with those who are clamoring for recognition and support by earthly rulers and human laws, but with those who are declaring to the people in his name those spiritual truths that will work in the receivers the experience of Paul, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Galatians 2:20. Then they will labor as did Paul for the benefit of men. He said, now then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled. 2 Corinthians 5:20, of which we had read earlier. And this is again taken from the Desire of Ages, pages 509 and 510. Just as soon as ministers go to the civil courts to try to get the government to exalt their teachings and their theories and their doctrines and their theology and their churches, you know that they have ceased depending upon Christ. Truth, beloved, is its own best defender, and it does not need any aid from the civil government nor carnal forces to advance its cause. Some of us remember the little state of Rhode Island and know of it. Roger Williams started that colony looking for a place of religious freedom. And he said this, "The armies of truth, like the armies of the apocalypse, must have no sword, helmet, breastplate, shield, or horse, but what is spiritual and of a heavenly nature." And that's from C.S. Longacre's book, Roger Williams, His Life, Work, and Ideals, page 81. In other words, friends, when you look at the armor of God in the Bible, there's not anything in that armor of God that's tangible, that's earthly. It's all something spiritual. It's peace. It's righteousness. It's the Word of God. It's all spiritual things, and that, as Christians, is our work. Now, Jesus laid out a principle for us. He summed up a principle that was taught in the Old Testament. In Mark chapter 12, and we're going to read verses 28 through 31. One of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, "Which is the first commandment of all?" And Jesus answered him, "The first of all commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment." And he said in verse 31, "And the second is like, namely this, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these." Now, where did Jesus get this idea? Well, in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 and 5, we're told that the Lord our God is what? One Lord, and we are to love Him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And in Leviticus chapter 19 and verse 18, we are told to love our neighbors ourselves. And Jesus said this was the greatest and the foremost commandment. And I want to tell you something, friends. If you will do this properly, you won't have time for anything else. You won't have time for the affairs and the kingdom of this world if you will put God first and put your neighbor second. In Matthew chapter 22, Jesus recognized that we all live under civil governments. And he didn't tell us to disregard that. In Matthew chapter 22 and verse 15, it says that the Pharisees took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk. And you remember the story of the tribute money. And they said, well, you know, what do we do about this? And Jesus said very simply unto them in verse 21, he says, "Render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's." And that is what we are to do as Christians. We aren't to ignore the things of Caesar. He has certain requirements upon us. And we'll look at the basis of those here maybe just for a second. Jesus is speaking about our duty. Two different duties, a duty to God and a duty to man. Now, if you think about the Ten Commandments, we generally understand that they were written on two tables, but within the division of those two tables, the first four commandments were on one table, representing our duty to God. The other six were on another table, representing our duty to man, as a whole, as we sum it up. And the things that reflect on the way we relate to man, the civil governments have a legitimate say-so, and we'll explain why also in a minute. But the things that relate to God, they have no say-so, nor authority, nor right within that. And there's such a thing that's been promulgated in the last few years called hate crimes. You ever hear about hate crimes? And hate crimes deal with your thoughts, your motives, and your intentions. But this was an area that Caesar has never been granted permission to interfere with by God. Now, if that hate, if you have hate in your heart for somebody or for a group of people, that's not right, and you will go to hell for that. You will be lost for that. I'll make that very clear. In God's judgment, that will be part of the deal. But if you do not ever demonstrate hate, if you do not do anything that hurts another person, you can have hate in your heart all you want on this earth, and no one has the authority to touch you or to hurt you or to do anything about that by God. They don't have the authority by God. But today we have what are called hate crimes. So someone goes out and they kill a person. Maybe they were a Jewish person. Maybe they were an African American. Maybe they were a Latino. And this person didn't like that kind of people, so they killed this person. And they're going to be charged for a hate crime now. Or maybe they just beat them up and they're charged for a hate crime for assault. But you know, we have civil laws already that protect people against assault. We have civil laws that protect people against murder already. And what we're going to do now is punish someone twice for one offense. But the real reason that this is done, the under core under this is Satan preparing the way, friends, so that if you have in what will be considered by others any religious intolerance to any religious group, then you can be dealt with even though you don't touch that person, you don't harm that person, you don't stop their interactions in any way, you don't affect their commerce, you don't do anything in a civil way against that person, you'll still be arrested and tried for a hate crime because maybe you said that the Pope was Antichrist or the Roman Catholic Church is the beast power. You're speaking derogatory. You're showing hate toward that group. And God has never delegated to any man or any government the right to make such a decision. Now, in the book Gospel Workers, page 396, quoting from Romans 14:7, she says, "None of us liveth to himself. Let those who are tempted to take part in politics remember that every move they make has its influence upon others. When ministers or others in responsible positions make remarks in regard to these matters, they cannot gather up the thoughts that they have planted in human minds." She says that we need to be very careful. We don't live unto ourselves, and every time we say something, it has an effect. And I want you to know that as a pastor and as a minister, every time that as I'm preparing a message, I'm thinking about how is this going to affect people, because that's why I'm doing this. I want to affect people. And what we do and what we say and the way we live, the words that we say, they do have an effect. And it's going to be either positively or negatively. And we want our words to have positive effects, beloved. But if we say the wrong thing, if we imply to people the wrong thing, if we start teaching the wrong things, we may never be able to undo that mess. Now, I have some very pointed testimonies I'd like to share with you. Those who teach the Bible in our churches and our schools are not at liberty to unite in making apparent their prejudices for or against political men or measures, because by so doing they stir up the minds of others, leading each to advocate his favorite theory. There are among those professing to believe present truth some who will thus be stirred up to express their sentiments and political preferences so that division will be brought into the church. The Lord would have his people bury political questions. On these themes, silence is eloquence. Christ calls upon his followers to come into unity on the pure gospel principles which are plainly revealed in the Word of God. We cannot with safety vote for political parties, for we do not know whom we are voting for. We cannot with safety take part in any political scheme. Let me just stop there. How many political schemes?
Any.
She says any. And you don't have to believe that. You don't have to agree with that. But I do. Because I believe it's the testimony of Jesus. And that's good enough for me. Those who are Christians indeed will be branches of the true vine and will bear the same fruit as the vine. They will act in harmony in Christian fellowship. They will not wear political badges, but the badge of Christ. What are we to do then? Let political questions alone. There is a large vineyard to be cultivated, but while Christians are to work among unbelievers, they are not to appear like worldlings. They are not to spend their time talking politics or acting politics, for by so doing, they give the enemy opportunity to come in and cause variance and discord. And then our last slide on this section from Councils for the Church, page 316. God's children are to separate themselves from politics, from any alliance with unbelievers. Do not take part in political strife. Separate from the world and refrain from bringing into the church or school ideas that will lead to contention and disorder. Dissension is the moral poison taken into the system by human beings who are selfish. And it's Councils for the Church, page 316. That sounds like pretty strong language to me, doesn't it to you? And, you know, Ellen White was a person who was given to sometimes speak strong things, and she wasn't afraid to say what she knew needed to be said. At the 1901 General Conference session, she stood on the platform. She said, there are men who have been ruling that have not been ruling under God's order, and he wants them removed. And these men were sitting right behind her. And you know what? The people listened, and they removed those men. And they started something that could have been much better, but in 2 years later, it was reversed, sadly. But something else Ellen White said, and I think she meant it, and this is in our next slide. This is from Fundamentals of Christian Education. Those teachers in the church or in the school who distinguish themselves by their zeal in politics should be relieved of their work and responsibilities. How? Without delay. Let me pause there. She says, if you've got teachers and workers and they're involved in these things, they should be fired. You get rid of those things. You're not to have that happening. She continues, for the Lord will not cooperate with them. The tithe should not be used to pay anyone for speechifying on political questions. Every teacher, minister, or leader in our ranks who is stirred with a desire to ventilate his opinions on political questions should be converted by a belief in the truth or give up his work. His influence must tell as a labor together with God in winning souls to Christ, or his credentials must be taken from him. If he does not change, he will do harm and only harm. In the name of the Lord, I would say to the teachers in our schools, attend to your point of work. You are not called upon by God to engage in politics. And then she quotes the text of Jesus, all ye are brethren. That's from Fundamentals of Christian Education, page 477. Now let's go back to the scripture for a minute in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13. Peter said, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king or supreme, or unto governors, as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of God, that with well-doing ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Who was the king? The Roman emperor at this time. The same one that would later have Peter killed. Peter said, honor him. He said, you're to surrender yourself to the authorities. The Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 13. Verses 1 through 3 said this, Romans chapter 13, 1 through 3. Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. Now, Paul is living under this same tyrannical government. The government that Ellen White mentioned, as we read earlier, was oppressive and abusive and had grinding cruelty. It still said that you are to recognize this government. Now, at times, they tried to take matters into their hands that didn't belong to them. And even when the Jewish government and the Sanhedrin tried to encourage the apostles to quit preaching about Jesus, Peter said in Acts chapter 5, verse 29, we ought to obey God rather than men. But how then we put this together? Because as we read there in these writings, it seems like that these powers are ordained of God. And Daniel, remember in Daniel chapter 2, verse 21, he said that the God of heaven, he sets up kings and he takes down kings. So how do we put all this together? Why is it that they are a terror to the evil and not to the good? I want you to go back with me. And Lamech said unto his wives, Ada and Zilpah. Hear my voice, ye wives of Lamech. Hearken unto my speech, for I have slain a man to my wounding and a young man to my hurt. Right back here in the very beginning of time, Cain had murdered Abel, but he wasn't the only murderer, was he? People were starting to take things into their own hands. When he says, I wounded a man to my own hurt. Other translation says, I've killed a man unto my own wounding. Other translation says, I've killed a man who wounded me. In other words, there was a fight. And someone had wounded him. Someone had done something to physically hurt him. And so in retaliation, he killed the man. And you find that the world was becoming very corrupt, so much so that God had to destroy it. But the fact was that human nature hadn't changed. Post-flood, pre-flood, it wasn't any different. And humanity left to itself becomes aggressive and will destroy one another. And to avoid this, God has allowed and even ordained civil government to keep a society civil. You know, the word civil means to have peace and to be in quietness. And so we have what we call today, we used to call civil governments. We used to teach a class in school, Bob, when we were younger, called civics. You know, they don't have civics classes in school anymore. We don't want our children to know about really what government is supposed to be about anymore. But the point is that if you don't have some kind of government in a sinful world, then everything ends up in anarchy, in chaos. The kind of government that God really wants is the kind of government that our parents taught us about when we were younger. They tried to teach us how to have what we call self-governance, to be self-governed, where people didn't have to be rulers and authority over you. People didn't have to try to tell you what to do because you were already doing what was right. But we, friends, in an ultimate Christian society and in heaven, that's the way it's going to be. We just have one Lord we look to, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're not going to need all these laws and rules and regulations like we have here in these things of the world. Why? Because there's no sin there. But in a world where we have sin, some kind of government becomes essential. And God's not against government of itself. He sets up rulers, and he does this. But I want to read you what A.T. Jones said in his book, Empires of the Bible. And this is from the 1904 edition. The reason I mention that is because I have also an 1897 edition. And this particular statement is not in the earlier edition. It's only in the 1904 edition. But speaking about that early, the early people, just after the flood, Nimrod and his people, says, but as apostasy continued, notice he calls it apostasy. These people, they were involved in an apostasy because they were moving away from God. But as apostasy continued, and the asserters of dominion and power over others became more bold, there came Nimrod, the first one who was so bold as to take to himself from the idols, the title and the prerogatives of king, which by the makers of the idols had been taken from God and placed upon the idols. So what he's saying is that he was the first one to take this prerogative, to be called a god, to be called a king. And continuing, he says, this is not to say that there should be no governments, nor is it to say that there should be no monarchy on earth. It is only to say that without such apostasy, there never could have been monarchy. But when such apostasy had come, and consequent turbulence and violence prevailed, it was better that there should be even monarchy, such as that of Nimrod, than that there should be no government at all, but only anarchy. It were better that there should be such government as that of Nimrod or of Nero, than that there should be none on earth. But apostasy must of necessity go a long way from truth and original government, self-government with God, before there could be required such government as that of Nimrod or of Nero. How do we submit ourselves to difficult things? Well, let's just go back in the book of Daniel for a minute and think about a story there. And, you know, those of you who read E.T. Jones and read a lot of his material like civil government and religion, so on. You know, he uses the book of Daniel a lot. In the book of Daniel, the king Nebuchadnezzar had set up the great image to himself and made the decree that everyone's to bow down to it, right? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to do that. They didn't bow down, did they? So were they in obedience to the ordinance? Well, yes, they were, in this sense. Because every law of the United States says you must do this or you must not do that, or else something happens, right? Because if you kill someone, there's a penalty for it. If you steal something, there's a penalty for it. If you disregard a duty, there's a penalty for it. Otherwise, it's not a real law. So there was a law here. You either bow down or you go in the fiery furnace. They just simply made the choice. We'll go in the fiery furnace. And that's what they did.
We all have to make choices.
And we all have to make choices today. That's right. The basic principles of religious liberty, though, friends, are simple enough that we don't need to be a rocket scientist nor a brain surgeon to understand them. And that's why I'm personally have been so surprised to see the notoriety that's recently been heaped upon Dr. Ben Carson in a field outside of medicine. Most of you know Dr. Ben Carson, don't you? He's the head of pediatric neurosurgery at Johns Hopkins Hospital. He's author of several books, including the book Gifted Hands. There was even a movie made about his life a while back. And Dr. Carson was the keynote speaker at the 2013 National Prayer Breakfast held February the 7th of this year. During this speech, Carson began by quoting scripture, but then ventured into several other areas, such as social and physical issues, including political correctness, education, the national debt, health care, and taxation. His speech hit YouTube, and the link was widely spread on the internet via email. Because of the unapologetic nature of the conservatism of his speech, with President Obama sitting just an arm width away, the speech made many heads turn. The Wall Street Journal announced, for instance, Ben Carson for president. Others, such as Fox News commentator Sean Hannity, encouraged Carson in a possible presidential run. And Carson noted, "If the Lord grabbed me by the collar and made me do it, I would." The New York Times of March 20 published this about Ben Carson. It says, "Neurosurgeon speeches have conservatives dreaming of 2016. And in that, the Times said this, "Overnight, he was embraced by conservatives, including those at the Wall Street Journal editorial page, which proclaimed Ben Carson for president, a suggestion Dr. Carson helped feed at a high-profile gathering last weekend, the Conservative Political Action Conference. He was interrupted by sustained cheers when he coyly said, 'Let's just say if you magically put me in the White House.'" Now, Carson announced that he's retiring from medicine this year to pursue other interests, including working with his foundation, but he did not rule out possible political adventures. The Times also noted in an interview they had, this is from an interview they had in his office with him, while Dr. Carson, 61, said that there were better candidates out there, he did not rule out a presidential run in 2016. "Certainly if a year and a half went by and there was no one on the scene and people are still clamoring, I would have to take that into consideration," he said in the interview. "I would never turn my back on my fellow citizens." Now, as the Times reported, we saw earlier, Dr. Carson spoke at what was called CPAC, or the Conservative Political Action Conference, that was held just this last week. And in fact, he spoke last March the 16th at that conference. Next slide. And does anybody remember what a week ago today, on March the 16th, what day of the week that was?
Sabbath.
It was Sabbath. And Sabbath morning, he's speaking at a political action committee rally. Carson even received enough votes at that conference in a straw poll for president that he was tied for seventh place, though he'd never run for any political office. And I want to ask a question. How can such a presentation, how can such involvement be excused upon the Holy Sabbath? I think it is beyond inspiration to answer. When we are told to honor the Sabbath, we are told to not make our own pleasure upon the Sabbath day. So what kind of an example does this set? Remember earlier we read the Testament, it says we have to be very careful and measured in our words and, you know, the things we say because they affect others. But you know, this has got a lot of people, a lot of conservatives, and a lot of Adventist conservatives buzzing. Boy, this would be great. Just think, what if he was president? But I'm reminded of what Ellen White writes in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 81. Those who have step by step yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs will not find it a hard matter to yield to the powers that be rather than subject themselves to derision, insult, threatened imprisonment, and death. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 81. Now I want to make something very clear. I greatly appreciate all the work that Dr. Carson has done to make people's lives better. I found his book, Gifted Hands, a really great book to read and very encouraging and inspirational. And one of his other books also I bought for a couple young people. I thought they were so good. And I don't wish to condemn him, but his actions should not be held up for emulation, as so many have done on the email circuit. Perhaps a question then that we should ask and answer is this: is the kingdom that we belong to of this world, or is it of heaven? Because your answer is going to determine what you do from here on out.